Okay, this is nuts. At first, I had no stream at all, and then I restarted my mixer, my encoder, and I was streaming, but I had no audio. Now we look like we have audio. Paul, you have audio. Give me a thumbs up, brother. And welcome to the Patriot Radio Show. I am your host, Tom O'Halloran, and I'm broadcasting today from my underground bunker deep in Arcantana, Brascarado. And I'm here to educate, irritate, and agitate. And folks, if you're half as agitated at the end of the show as I am getting the show started, I'll have done my job. Two false starts here this morning. That's, I think, a record. Again, my name's Tom O'Halloran. My primary blog, TomOHalloran.com. When you get there, please follow me on Facebook, Twitter, Spreaker, all the other social media that you enjoy. You can find us on Facebook at Facebook.com/Patriot Radio Show. Personally, I'm at Facebook.com/O'Halloran. And I'm on air 5 days a week, so please tune in 9 a.m. Texas time, Monday through Thursday, for the Patriot Radio Show. On Fridays, I do Jihad on America. Here, I talk about the Islamists in America, who they are, what they want, and why you should be afraid. If you did not hear my show, The Muslim Brotherhood, my show Islam is Not a Religion, or my show on Islamophobia, then please find your way to PatriotRadioShow.com and catch all three of these shows. They'll give you insight and perspective on the Islamic topic that you've probably not heard elsewhere. They'll also give you a solid foundation upon which we build each and every Friday as we continue to pull back the mask of Islam, looking at what's being done in the name of Allah, both here and abroad. And I do the news about Islam around the world because it's a glimpse into the future of what's in store for us here in America if we continue to allow the cancer of Islam to spread. Keep abreast of my shows, listen to the live stream, as well as catch up on any shows you may have missed, all at PatriotRadioShow.com. The show is rebroadcast daily at Liberty Works Radio Network. That's LWRN.net. You can also take the show with you on the go with your iPhone or Android by downloading the TuneIn app and doing a search for the Patriot Radio Show. And if you're a ham radio operator, I am Whiskey 2 TPO. It can usually be found on Echolink node 7212 out of Stagecoach, Texas. Okay, it has been a rocky start. I first launched, my encoder wasn't running, so nothing was going out. I restarted the show, and lo and behold, the music went out, the intro, but I had no audio. In the restart of the encoder, I forgot to push one button. So we are live, long at last. I'm going to start the show the way we always do on Fridays, with an update on what the religion of peace has been up to in the last number of periods. Since 9/11/2001, there have been 28,619 Islamic terror attacks. In the past 30 days, there have been 231 attacks in 31 countries, killing 1,883, and severely wounding another 2,206. Welcome to the chat room, Catherine. You have missed nothing. The boys will tell you about it in the chat room. In the past week, there have been 55 Islamic terror attacks in 15 countries, killing 421 and severely injuring 412. Over the past 7 days, the Islamic terror attacks included, but are not limited to, in Cameroon, the bodies of 42 fishermen are found a few days after they were captured by Boko Haram. In Orlando, Florida, 49 killed by an Islamic extremist. As an Islamic extremist massacres 49 people at a gay nightclub, 53 wounded. In Syria, a double suicide bombing outside a Shiite mosque leaves at least 20 dead. Afghanistan, a religious extremist plants a bomb in a rival mosque that eliminates 4 worshippers, 70 severely wounded. In Iraq, Islamists spray machine gun fire into a crowd of women and children trying to flee the caliphate, killing at least 30. Also in Syria, Islamists drag 4 women out of their homes and slit their throats. ISIS members in Syria massacre at least 37 villagers, including women and children. Iraq, Baghdad, a Sunni suicide bomber targets a commercial district in Shiite area, killing 19, 46 severely wounded. These are Muslims killing Muslims, my friend. Muslims killing Muslims. They live to kill infidels, non-believers. You and me. But this is what they do in their spare time. In Somalia, dozens of AU? Australian, I guess, peacekeepers are massacred during an Al-Shabaab suicide assault. With, what was that? I lost my place, but I believe that was 50 dead. AU, there it is. 43 dead on that one. And in Afghanistan, the Taliban stopped vehicles along a highway and massacred dozens of occupants. A dozen occupants. 12 dead, 50 severely wounded. Again, Muslims killing Muslims. In the UK, the newly elected Muslim mayor, Sadiq Khan. You see, this happens when they get enough of their Muslim friends all in one area. They tend to start electing them into office. Sadiq Khan addressed a crowd as part of the EU exit, or anti-EU exit campaign. They're traveling around on buses, holding speeches and rallies, trying to get people out to vote. Sadiq Khan, of course, wants the EU, wants the UK to stay in the EU. That way, Muslims can travel freely to the UK. He spoke before a crowd that, and bear in mind, this is in England, Manchester to be exact. The men were in front, the women were in back. He's a Muslim mayor, he's going to impart Muslim law, Sharia law. The women couldn't possibly sit or stand with the men. There in the back, probably behind the dogs. It is not uncommon for men and women to be separated in mosques, but this incident will be seen as significant after Mr. Khan received criticism for banning an advertisement earlier this week. The advertisement depicted a woman in a bikini, something that's banned under Sharia law. Khan claimed the reason for the ban was that it served that which can demean people, particularly women, and make them ashamed of their bodies. It will demean women. You've got masks, you've got burqas on your women at the meeting. You put a burqa on your wife during a sign-in. You make them stand at the back. You tell men they can beat their wives, and you feel an ad with a bikini woman on it is demeaning to women. The mayor is a controversial figure in the UK, not least because he is a close friend of Babar Ahmad, a convicted Al-Qaeda terrorist. Mr. Ahmad was supported by Khan as he fought an 8-year campaign against extradition to the US to face charges of conspiracy and providing material support to terrorism. A friend of terrorism is the mayor of London. God help the UK. ISIS crucifies 3 people for breaking a Ramadan fast. Men held in cages for a number of hours before receiving 70 lashes and being crucified on a cross. And back to America. Since Orlando, my friends, which was just this past week, this past weekend, I should say, there have been 441 Syrian refugees admitted to the United States. Dozens of them had gone to Florida. In the days since the Islamic attack, 441 refugees have been settled in communities across the United States. They've been relocated into 26 states, with Illinois getting 60, Florida getting 49, and Arizona getting 38. Those are the largest groupings of them. Of the 49 refugees resettled in Florida last week, 10 have been resettled in the greater Orlando area. 49 went to Florida. Is that intentional? I mean, 49 Americans get killed by a Muslim, and they're replaced by 49 Muslims? I'm not sure whether that was intentional or not. Let's see. Governor Rick Scott said he is opposed to resettling Syrian refugees in his state amid ongoing vetting concerns. The vetting concerns. Tuesday, following the attack, Scott expressed frustration that the administration is refusing to share information about the Syrians placed in his state. The White House said they will not share the information with the Florida law enforcement. They said, that privacy rights, the Muslims' privacy rights, have to be addressed. Scott said, what about our security rights? The security and making sure that if you live in my state, you're going to be safe. I'm responsible for the people of my state. I'm fed up with the fact that we're not destroying ISIS. We're not vetting these people. We're not taking care of our own citizens. We have a pissed off governor. Thank God. The Obama administration has dramatically increased the processing speed in order to meet his goals of resettling at least 10,000 refugees in the United States this fiscal year. He is concerned about his goals. We're going to speed up the vetting process. We're not going to slow it down to make sure who we're bringing in. We're just going to speed it up so that I can meet my goal. His goal of 10,000 or his goal of destroying America? The administration has accelerated the pace of resettlement despite warnings from top security officials about potential vulnerabilities in vetting migrants from terror-laden hotspots like Syria, and reports that ISIS operatives have infiltrated the refugee flows. In written testimony prepared for a Tuesday hearing of the Senate Intelligence Committee, CIA Director John Brennan again warned about the potential for ISIS operatives to manipulate the refugee system as well as other immigration paths. He said, we judge that ISIL in training and attempting to deploy operatives for further attacks. ISIL has a large cadre of Western fighters who could potentially serve as operatives for attacks in the West. And the group is probably exploring, he says, a variety of means for infiltrating operatives into the West, including refugee flows, smuggling routes, and legitimate methods of travel. Our top security person, the head of the CIA, says that it is impossible to vet these people. Every Muslim country in the Middle East has refused to take a single Muslim refugee. The purpose they give is the same one across the area, because it is impossible to vet them and to sort out the terrorists from the real refugees. If the Muslim countries can't vet them and won't take them in for the protection of their own people, what in the hell are we doing bringing these savages here? From the chat room, somebody just said that the Saudis, Laura Cambria says, the Saudis are pouring billions into Central Florida. Yes, they are. The billions go to both the resettlement organizations, the churches, the foundations that will help them get settled in, but they also go to politicians to allow these people to come in here. One Muzzy is not the majority of Muzzies, but one gun means all guns are bad. Exactly right, from Bill Perriman. Why is it that when somebody shoots up a nightclub, they're going to ban all guns because all people with guns are evil? And yet, because it was a Muslim and we say Muslims are bad, they get down our throat for grouping all Muslims together. All gun owners are bad, all Muslims. You can't do that. It's insane. It's insane. And I missed a thing here. Still no evidence in Orlando. I can't play this video on air, but we have been talking about hoaxes over the last couple of years. The Sandy Hook hoax. The Colorado theater shooting hoax with actors being used. And I was unaware until just this week that even the Charleston shooting was a hoax. The preacher who we saw his body in a casket. It was a hoax. If you go online and Google Charleston shooting hoax, there are videos. The man in the casket was a wax figure. And his face was not... it was not the same as the preacher's. The ears were far too, I believe it was too low. His face was too wide. It was a hoax. And we've yet to see any real data on a real crime being held in Florida. We're suspecting, we're still looking for the data on it, but we're suspecting that this was another staged shooting. Whether it was or not, we're yet to be determined. Bill Perriman says the money coming in to Central Florida is to the Islamic groups for a caliphate. That's even scarier, brother. That's even scarier. We need to get Donald Trump elected. That is the most important thing that we have before us today. Hillary Clinton has accepted dozens of millions, I think it was $24 million, from Saudi Arabia, one of the largest funders of terrorism, from one of the largest perpetrators of violence. She's accepting this money. She has already pledged that she will bring in 300,000 Muslim refugees in her first year. She is aligned with Obama, but even more ruthless. Even more ruthless. They are going to try to outbreed us. If we bring in all of these Muslims, they will vote Democrat. You see, these Democrats think they'll stay in office with that happening. They don't realize their Democrat butts will be voted out. And Muslim Democrats will be voted in. Muslim Democrats who will install Sharia law, much like has been installed in London in just a month since. In just the month since the mayor was elected. Laura in the chat room says, Loretta Lynch has been meeting with the BLM. Oh, that's not the Bureau of Land Management. This is Black Lives Matter. For racial violence at both conventions, BLM's leaders' phones hacked, and it confirms. There's a video. Go online and Google heads up leader hacked. Google that on, or search for it on Facebook. The leader of Black Lives Matter, his phone has been hacked. I'm going to open that up in a link. I won't be able to play it while I'm online, but I will listen to it right after the show. This is serious, folks. I'm going to veer a little bit off of the jihad thing today, but it's all the same stuff right now. The ACLU has sued Cleveland, thanks to Richard in the chat room for sending me this morning. The ACLU is suing Cleveland over draconian reach of the RNC protest rules. With all the violence, every time Donald Trump has gone anywhere to speak, with all the violence, the city has set up a 3-square-mile zone where they are controlling. They're controlling protests. They're controlling how long you can stay. How many people can assemble. All sorts of things. They're trying to manage it to keep the city safe. Now, I am not a fan of free speech zones. You've got to know this if you've listened to my show. Free speech is free speech. I was livid when a law was passed 2 years ago giving the Secret Service the ability to set up free speech zones around any candidate that they were managing. Free speech zones. Mind-boggling. If somebody in the chat would copy all these links, they're going too fast for me to manage. If you would copy them and email these links to me, I would greatly appreciate it. Okay, I want to see all of those stories, but I can't do it while I'm on air. And if we wait till the show's off, they'll scroll off the page. So please, copy the links down and email them to me. Now, this free speech zone is unconstitutional. But it passed Congress. In fact, only 3 congressmen voted against it. One of them was Ron Paul, and I'm not a Ron Paul fan, but he certainly got a lot of kudos from me on that. 2 other congressmen voted against it. The others, all Democrats and Republicans, voted to enact a law inhibiting free speech. This means any time the Secret Service is set up to protect an event, a candidate's speech, a president's speech such as, then the Secret Service can set up a free speech zone saying, yes, you can protest this person, but you have to protest it 3 blocks away. Well, what good is a protest if you're 3 blocks away? What good is that? That is not free speech. That's inhibiting free speech. The First Amendment says that Congress shall pass no law inhibiting free speech. Abridging, I think, is the word. So I'm very much against it. But when at event after event where Donald Trump goes, paid rioters show up and create mayhem. This is not free speech. This is crime. This is violence. This is conservatives going to see a candidate and getting pelted with fists, with chairs, with bottles. And I know people are going to start saying, Tom, you can't soften your position because of what happened. It's the camel's nose under the tent. You start letting them do it, they'll just continue to do it. But my friends, until we can get an administration that will prosecute these paid rioters, until we get somebody that will prosecute the paid rioters, we need to protect the citizens of Cleveland. We need to protect the citizens that are going there to see the debate, to protest civilly. So I'm afraid I've got to go with the city on it. I hate to say it, but it's really not free speech they're abridging. They're stopping the riots, or they're trying to control the riots. So give me some feedback in the chat room on the subject. It's really an odd position for me to take, because I'm very, very adamantly against the whole concept of free speech zones. I have a free speech zone. It's called the United States of America. And with that, I'm going to take a quick break, get some bills paid, do some calculations on when I actually started the show so I know how long to go. My friends, stick with us. We'll be right back. It's Jihad on America on a Friday morning. Stick around.
I know the one place where you are guaranteed to find a great guy. You know, the kind of guy that carries you off on horseback and flies you to Paris and likes to talk about his feelings. He's at the movies. Well, in the movies. Where else will you find a funny architect with airbrushed abs? Girls are lining up for guys like this, but not you, because you bought your tickets ahead on Fandango. So adios, long lines, and hello, handsome astronaut, brain surgeon, spy.
Make a date with Fandango, your ticket to the movies.
Family night at the movies is a tradition. It really bonds us together. I love you guys so much, especially this one. I mean, of course, there's all the, his popcorn's bigger than mine, and she's hitting me. Fandango makes it all so easy with tickets in advance. Honey, you enjoy the chick flick? Kids, you enjoy the animated movie? Daddy's gonna go watch things go boom. That's how we do family movie night.
Bring your family closer together with Fandango, your ticket to the movies.
Boost Mobile believes you deserve more choice.
You can pick your phone,
pick your plan,
and
you can even pick a new spokesperson and a sell that phone.
The Samsung Galaxy S5 will rock your face off.
Give it to me through peers.
Get unlimited talk, text, and data. Starting at $40 a month.
Wow.
Pick your phone.
Pick your plan.
And pick your next spokesperson at BoostMobile.com.
Visit Boost Mobile through the RER Marketplace.
Hello, Patriots. This is Tom O'Halloran. I recently celebrated the show's second anniversary and 350th show. As I embark on my third year on the air, I'm asking each of you to consider showing your support for the show in a way that will make a real difference. While it's only an hour show, there are also 3 to 4 hours of show prep and another hour of cutting, posting, and promoting the show afterwards. This is nearly 2,100 hours spent gathering together the stories to enlighten you with on a daily basis. When a family man takes time away from the family to this degree, it's looked at as a hobby. But the thing about hobbies is that they are fun. This show is far from fun. It is work. Depressing work at times, but it's also become a calling too. Something that is needed to wake America up to the things that threaten our way of life. From the Islamic attacks on our soil to the LGBT invasion of our ladies' restrooms to the border situation and the out-of-control Congress. The point is, it takes time and it costs money. Please take a minute to click on the red banner at the top of the center column and do what you can to keep this show on the air. And a heartfelt thank you to those of you that have been contributing and supporting the show all along, without which I would not have been able to stay on air as long as I have. Thank you, and God bless.
I reckon the storms are brewing. Reckon so.
Reckon you got a hotel?
Reckon no. Money's tight.
Reckon Priceline Express deals can get you a great deal, wherever you mosey.
You reckon?
We reckon.
I reckon our work here is done. Vamanos!
Express deals. Priceline savings without the bidding.
Think he's happy?
Ooh, I reckon.
Tom O'Halloran, holding the line against tyranny from Washington, D.C.
I am America, one voice, united we stand. I am America, one hope to heal our land. There is still work that must be done. I will not rest until we
And we are back. It's the Patriot Radio Show, and I am your host, Tom O'Halloran. The Orlando shooting, I want to go back to that for a couple of minutes. We've seen repeatedly these false flag events where we have a staged shooting. We have the media come out. We have actors trying to act like their child was just shot. None of them have obviously ever had a child shot. I remember the video I saw the other night of the Charleston. They were standing there straight-faced and happy. Yes, well, since my mom was shot yesterday, I've been very reflective, and I feel so full of love, and I've forgiven the man that shot her. Come on. Nobody ever talks that way or feels that way after your mother or your children are shot. And yet, one after another of these events, these people are standing there, obviously paid actors. In fact, proven paid actors. In that event, now this was in the Sandy Hook event. In the Sandy Hook event, there was one man that played a SWAT team member. He had all the SWAT gear on and everything. And he also came out later in the day as a parent of one of the so-called kids. Really? A SWAT team member and a parent of one of the kids? Really? Well, the man, turns out, he is an actor. He's actually a Hollywood actor and has been in a number of films. So there's no question that several of these events have been false flags aimed at stirring up people so they can get anti-gun bills passed. That's the sole purpose of it. In virtually every instance, we've been able to look at advertisements beforehand. Go back a week or two before the event, and you'll see ads in the local papers or on Craigslist advertising for crisis actors, for a drill, an active shooter drill. Oh, we're just going to do a drill. Right, and during the period, the 4 or 5 day period that this exercise is going to go on, there's actually an active shooter. Gee, what a coincidence. Virtually every time this happens, this is the case. Now, why they did another one is simple. The same reason. Gun grab. They're going out again trying to get more guns. Now the UN Human Rights Chief says the United States needs robust gun regulation. Yeah, well, how about this? How about you kiss my ass? Okay? The UN doesn't dictate what laws we have, what regulations we have in the United States. We have a First Amendment, which the United, or Second Amendment, which the United Nations doesn't have. Now, Obama is aligned with the UN because the UN is highly anti-American. Highly anti-American. So, of course, he's pro-UN. It's understandable why they had this event. They want to grab the guns. But why they had it during this campaign doesn't make a lot of sense. It doesn't make a lot of sense. Because people like their guns. And you're going to rile people up in favor of the guns. Everything Obama has done to try to take away our guns, to try to curtail our gun rights and ability to buy guns, all he has done is driven up the gun sales. They've surged again since Sunday. This is probably the gay community going out to arm themselves because they think gays have been shot at this club. I seriously doubt anybody was shot. Now, you could easily watch the Orlando newspaper for funeral notices, although there's enough money behind the gun movement, the anti-gun movement, that they probably would hold fake funerals, caskets and all, to cover this phony thing. But what strikes me as mind-boggling is why would they stage a false flag shooting event with a Muslim during the campaign season when Donald Trump is wanting to seal the border up and stop immigration? all that's going to do is get more people to come out and say Donald Trump is right. This shooting, and I said this right after it happened, the silver lining here, and it's hard to say silver lining, you know, when you're saying 50 dead, but the silver lining was that shooting is going to help Donald Trump get elected. And it will, whether it was a real shooting or not, it's going to help him get elected. But the whole idea of staging it and having it fake and using a Muslim, that's going to stir up the people that want immigration stopped. It's already stirred up the governor of Florida, who probably isn't aware that it's a staged event. I don't know whether he's aware that these others are or not. Some people, some intelligent people, some of them good friends of mine, were blind to the whole false flag staged event until just recently. So people are starting to be aware, starting to wake up to this. So why use a Muslim for it? That I don't know. And it bothers me. It really does. It bothers me. Because I don't think these people are that stupid. So I'm trying to figure out what their game plan was. What was the desired outcome of using a Muslim for this shooting? But because it got people like me, it got people all across the country that are anti-Muslim, anti-Muslim immigration, anti-Sharia. It got a lot of people talking and stirring people up. So it's going to work against them. So what were they trying to do? If you've got any ideas, post them in the chat room. If you listen to this from the archives, then please just email me. My email address is tpo@tpo.net. I'd be happy to hear your thoughts. Okay, one last thing that's not exactly Islam-related, but disturbing. The FBI is installing utility pole surveillance cams, and they were being challenged in Seattle. They want to keep the locations of these cameras secret. Well, I can see why they would want that. But we are now... No, Bill. TPO@TPO.net. TPO@TPO.net. Thomas Patrick O'Halloran at ThomasPatrickO'Halloran.net. It is mind-boggling that the FBI is mounting these cameras on utility poles to begin with. What happened to our rights? What happened to surveillance? We were told that we were not going to be surveilled like this. And now it turns out that we are being surveilled. And I can understand why the FBI is doing it. I think to be completely honest, I think my biggest problem is the fact that the FBI won't surveil Muslims. We know what the biggest threat to this country is. It's Islamic terrorism. And yet these people will not investigate terrorism. They will not investigate mosques. We have 28 known terrorist training camps in the United States. These are owned by a Pakistani who is affiliated with several terror attacks. We know that they're there. We know where they are. And they're still allowed to operate. Why doesn't the FBI focus on the known terror? There are 1,000 open cases involving ISIS in the United States. 1,000 cases open at this time. Current ongoing investigations of ISIS cells in the United States. There are 100 plus known ISIS cells in the United States. Why are we not rounding these people up? Why is the FBI not taking action? I'll tell you why. Because the director of the FBI, John Brennan, is a Muslim. No, he's the head of the CIA, pardon me. The head of the FBI is... I'm drawing a blank on his name. Cooley, Cole, something like that. Obama has seven Muslim Brotherhood affiliated advisors. They have gotten Obama to remove all reference to Islamic terror attack from FBI training manuals. They're not allowed to even mention that. They're not allowed to mention it in their training. If you can't mention Islamic training, Islamic terror, if you can't mention radical Islam, then how are you going to train and stop these people? FBI Director Combs, thank you. And he's not a political. This is what bothers me. He's not a political. He has his job. The FBI director cannot be replaced by Obama. He has his job. It's a 10-year job from the day he gets appointed, which is why he will pursue Hillary Clinton. I'm hoping he's waiting to... Comey, that's it. I knew Coombs didn't sound quite right. Comey it is. Jay Johnson, head of DHS, is a Muslim. So we've got Muslims in at least two, and probably more like six, departments, at the heads of the departments. But they've infiltrated every department. We've got Muslims with top, ultra-top secrets. There are Muslim Brotherhood-affiliated advisors that have access to databases where they can pull up every port showing where the manholes are, where the electrical grid is, where the security lines are, where the alarms are. They can pull up the electrical grid for any city, for the entire country. They've got access to everything. And if you don't think that they're pulling this information up and sharing it with the Islamists, then, my friend, the terrorists have already won. So all of this is going on. Meanwhile, the FBI is installing cameras on streetlights across America to monitor the average citizen. Already, police have scanners on their cars. There are scanners on bridges. As you drive down the highway, they scan license plates. Good luck having a false alibi, because they scan license plates along highways all across America now. If you're driving down the road and you have an expired plate, you're likely to have a cop pull you over, because it'll blip and an alert will go out. If you're wanted, or if you're under surveillance, say for being a loudmouth radio talk piece, they can follow you wherever you go. Not just with your cell phone, but they can track your car. And now with video cams. It's frightening. This is not the America that we grew up in. This is not what we call liberty. This is not freedom. This is... Day by day, we're becoming more of a totalitarian state with Big Brother watching us. Big Brother. Remember 1984? They didn't miss it by much, did they? There's a sequel to that. I forget what the year on the sequel is. But I haven't read that. I forgot about it, but I need to look that up. It's scary because we are way, way down the road from personal liberty, personal freedom, and privacy. And with that, we're going to take our second break. And I'm going to get caught up on the chat room, but we will be right back. We've got a lot more to cover, my friends. Please stick around.
Attention patriots and conservative Americans. Have you ever wondered why the Tea Party did so well in 2010, but has not accomplished much since? Have you ever wondered where your money goes when you donate to these various national Tea Party groups, and then what do they do with it? The new blockbuster book, Ego in a Teabag, written by Ken Crow, an original Tea Party organizer and activist, is a tell-all about the seedy side of the Tea Party. Ego in a Teabag exposes the corruption, greed, and deceit behind this great American movement. Along with the exposing of the bat, the book also details how the Tea Party will become the most powerful political organization in America in the coming years. Order your copy today from Amazon.com to be released at the end of April. Just click on the picture of Ken's book on PatriotRadioShow.com and reserve your copy of Ego in a Teabag today.
Hi there, my name is Mark Kranerig, and welcome to my kitchen. Today we're going to talk about my favorite order from Chicago Steak Company. It's the classic crime assortment. All right, well, let's open up and have a look what's inside. So right away, we've got 2 6-ounce filet mignons. If you know anything about steak, it's really rare to see filet mignons with that kind of marbling in it. Just beautiful steak. And then next, we've got the 2 12-ounce USDA prime strip steaks. Just look at how thick these things are. They're just beautiful. Again, beautifully marbled, amazing steak. Then we've got 2 USDA prime ribeyes. And if you like steak that is just mouthwatering, this is the steak for you. With all that marbling inside, you'll see it's thicker. The marbling is a lot thicker. That just means more moisture throughout your steak. Now we've got 6 USDA prime top sirloin steaks. These are the steaks that everyone's gonna love. Then we're moving into our next package. Next, we have 16 4-ounce gourmet Angus steak burgers. These are amazing burgers that everyone's gonna love. And to top it all off, they give you one container of my favorite steak seasoning of all time, the Chicago Steak Spice, and you're gonna love it too. So there you have the classic prime assortment, my favorite and your ultimate steak experience. So be sure to order your steak today at mychicagosteak.com. I'm Mark. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, and we'll see you next time at mychicagosteak.com.
Jungle. I am Tom O'Halloran. My co-host Ken Crow and I will guide you through the maddening nightmare of American politics right here every day at 11 a.m. Central Time. We'll take you through the haze and fog of both conservative and liberal spin, help you to see the truth as it is. No matter your political bent, this is the place you can come to vent and be heard at thepoliticaljungle.net.
Tom O'Halloran.
We'll put a boot in your ass. It's the American way. All brought to you courtesy of the red, white, and blue. Oh, of my red, white, and blue.
And we are back. It is the Jihad on America show. And I'm your host, Tom O'Halloran. We're talking today about what's going on. Orlando, a staged attack, in all likelihood anyway. We've got the election going on. We've got a convention coming up in Cleveland. And just announced in the chat room a few minutes ago during the break, FEMA has just called a lot of people together down to Atlanta, Georgia, to the CDC for some training. Why is this all happening right now? Something's getting ready to go. Something big's getting ready to happen. I don't know what. I'm not a conspiracy theorist, but I am a realist. And when you see things happening and nothing is being said about it, why a secret meeting to call people from all over the country? This is the FEMA secret army, the civilian army that Obama was talking about. And why are they now being called down for some special training? Are they getting ready for riots? Are they going to be part of some kind of martial law? Is this going to be played out during the convention? During the Democratic or the Republican convention? I don't know, but we need to be aware. We need to ask these questions. What is happening? I know FEMA's been building these big camps, and they've been doing that for years, even predating Obama. And I know they've got hundreds of thousands of coffins stacked up and prepared. We know that Obama's been building this civilian army. We know that FEMA's been buying ammunition. What does FEMA need ammunition for? Federal Emergency Response Team? What do they need ammo for? They're there to help people, right? In case of floods or something. Something's going on. And we're at a crossroads. We're at a crossroads here in America. We have an election coming up in November. And we either take the blue pill, elect Donald Trump, and get America back on track. Or we take the red pill, elect Hillary, and we accelerate our descent into an Islamic socialist society. If we even get to take the pills, what's going on might be Obama's play to subvert the election. If we have rioting, and remember, these riots aren't just happening. George Soros' organization has been funding anarchist organizations for years. And over the last year, they have been behind. They've been a major funder of Baltimore riots, of the Ferguson riots, of any unrest that's happened to this country. They're being paid by the left, in this case by George Soros. If enough people get out and riot and protest at the conventions in enough cities, not if it's just in Cleveland, but if it happens, the riots happen across the country, then it wouldn't be out of the realm of feasibility for Obama to declare a national martial law. He's been trying to divide the blacks from the whites, the rich from the poor, for 7 years now. And the anger is there, and it's very real. As I mentioned just a little bit ago, the leader of the Black Lives Matter's phone has been hacked, and he's been speaking with the secretary of the DOJ. He's been having conversations with her. What are they doing? What are they planning? But if they get enough rioting in enough cities, Obama could say, I need to declare martial law. I need to declare martial law. We will postpone all elections. If they postpone elections, then all the primaries will be nullified. And if and when he declares that we'll have elections again, it'll be a new game. They'll probably start all over again, and we'll lose the momentum that we have for Donald Trump. if Donald Trump survives the unrest. And that's a real concern, too. These people are haters. They're violent. Clinton has... The Clintons together have, I believe the number's up around 150. People that they know personally that have killed themselves or been killed since Clinton's days in the White House. Many of them had information about Bill Clinton's misdoings, whether it be his rapes of the girls or his doing drugs in the White House in Little Rock. Many of them were guards that were around him during his time of service that saw things, that knew what he had done. And they just all start dying away and have died away over the years. I don't think it's unlikely that an attack from either the Obama or the Clintons would be taken upon Donald Trump. Donald Trump is so pro-America, so pro-getting the country back on track, so pro-getting these elitists out of office, so pro-getting us back to capitalism, doing away with welfare, making people get off their lazy asses and go to work, so pro-untaxing corporations so they can afford to expand and create more jobs. Donald Trump is the antithesis of the Clintons and Obama. He is a serious, serious threat. Not only to their agenda, but let's face it. If FBI Director Comey waits until Donald Trump is the president and then indicts the Clintons, both of them, and perhaps Chelsea as well, because she's been very deeply involved in the Clinton Foundation and fundraising. They're going to jail, folks. Now, if Comey moves before Trump is in office, then it's possible for Barack Obama to pardon her. I don't know if you can pardon somebody before a guilty verdict or if you can pardon them from an indictment. If you have to have a guilty verdict, then we're safe, because there's no way that they would get a guilty verdict even if they indicted her today. They wouldn't be able to get a verdict before February. It would take a year to get her into court. But the thing of it is if Donald Trump becomes the president, the Clintons will go down. They will go down. Not just their legacy, but they will lose all their money. Their assets will be seized. And they will go to jail. Because many, many serious felonies have been committed. Some of them treasonous. Several of them treasonous. Some of them are financially felonious. But they will go down. So what is going on? FEMA is ramping up. We know that the Cleveland Convention is going to be the thing to watch. We don't know what, we don't know when, we don't know how. But that is the time when the most of the violence will probably occur, because they'll be able to blame that on Donald Trump. They won't blame it on George Soros, the one that's paying all these people's bills. Quick roundup from the chat room before we bail. Reddit will adjust algorithm to censor Trump supporters. They're too popular. Yes, this is not a surprise. It's happened on Twitter. It's happening on Google, YouTube now. Boom. It's news dump day. Yes, watch the news, because this is the day. Friday is the day that the low job numbers, anything they don't want you to see in the news, is released in a quiet mode today. The White House response to Orlando was, if nobody cares about 30 dead 8-year-olds shot in Connecticut, Who would care about if 1,000 homosexuals were killed during the Pride Parade? Means nobody cares. I think she's being a little on the facetious side there. But yeah, they don't care in the White House. They really don't care. The Summer of Violence is sponsored by Hillary and Soros, yes. When La Raza gears up with attacks, make Muzzy attack look like a walk in the park. That's a fact. That's a fact, Jack. All right, my friends. It was a rough start with our technological problems this morning, but we did get a show. We went a little bit off track thanks to the feedback and input from the chat room. I love you guys. I appreciate you being here and driving the show as you do. God bless you and yours, America. This is Tom O'Halloran. I'm out. Tune in 1 hour at thepoliticaljungle.net. Thepoliticaljungle.net for me and Ken Crow. Very special show over there.